from Luke chapter 1, verse 26 to 37. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man named Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and the angel came to her and said, "Greetings, favored woman, the Lord is with you." But she was deeply troubled by the statement, wondering what kind of greeting this could be. Then the angel told her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. Now listen, you will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will have no end." Mary asked the angel, "How can this be, since I have not had sexual relations with a man?" And the angel replied to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. And consider your relative Elizabeth. Even she has conceived a son in her old age. And this is the sixth month for her who was called childless. For nothing will be impossible with God." This is the Lord's word.
It's been an amazing morning so far. Absolutely loved it. I always say thank you to our hosts, so thank you, Cornel. I always say thank you to our worship ministry, so thank you for that. I always say thank you to the person who read the teaching text. Thank you, Pam. I want to say thank you to all of you this morning for really leaning in when we baptize people. I don't always know where to look, you know, so I've got my hand on the shoulder of the person who I'm about to baptize, and then I just look up and I see all the kids going, yes, and then I look a little bit further and I see all the adults going, oh, this is so beautiful, and then I look back in the eye of the person I'm about to baptize. I love baptism services at our church, so thank you so much just for joining in the experience. You might not remember this, but we've had November baptism in 21, 22, and 23. This is the first time that we had a proper summer's day when baptizing people at the end of the year. Our very first baptism service year, 28 November 2021, we baptized Tebogo and Andrew and Grace and their family. It was 12 degrees outside. We like, summer baptism, this is awesome. Maybe we should do it in open air. And in the end, when they got out of the baptism bath, they went, please just rush the prayer. And it's been like that every year. Every time when we baptize people, a cold front hits us. And now today, we're sitting in the sauna. Okay, so I just want you to know that it's hot. And I'm still excited to preach the word. And also remember, when it's hot and when you sit, your veins and your legs dilate. So the blood drains from your upper body into your legs. And then pulls your eyelids down. It slows your heart rate. And then you go. And then you miss it. So don't miss it. Okay, coffee and tea station, right there. Go and get your caffeine fix. We also have a sugar alternative in the juice there. I'm really excited about starting our new series today. It's called Holy Night. You'll see it on our artwork. And this will take us all the way to Christmas. The idea of the series is really simple. We'll journey through the story of the Bible, more specifically as it is told in the Gospels in the New Testament, to get to the Holy Night. The night that was the start of the good news. The night when God became a human. The holy night is the night when Jesus was born. Now the Gospels, according to Luke and to Matthew, start by telling us of these two people who we just saw in the video clip that had to walk in faith, that had to trust, and that had to be obedient so that God can do something that is impossible because He said so. That was the gist of the video. I wanted you to see, maybe in a visual format, what this struggle and this belief and faith and trust and obedience must have been like. The two of them said, God said so. Do you remember? Yes, I remember. Do you remember? Yes, I remember. Well, then that means God can do it and He will do it. Both of them only had one message, fam. One. She had one. We read about it in Luke. He had one in Matthew 1. We'll get there later. And that's what they had to put their full weight on it. One message that they had to simply choose to believe in. One message that they simply had to respond to. And the promise that was given to them, specifically to Mary, was in verse 37. Nothing will be impossible with God. Just sit with that. And then let me ask you, do you believe this? Do you believe this? And are you willing to keep on believing this? Because you might feel all the feels now, but come Monday and you face an unexpected challenge, it whittles away at this yes you just said. And then I want to ask you, will you be obedient to the God of whom this is true? Because the Bible says it's true. And then when we respond in obedience. That's also our theme for today. Nothing is impossible with God. And it's taken directly from the teaching text, which is verse 37. I want to ask one question and offer you four answers. Why does this sometimes feel impossible? Why does this sometimes feel impossible? Sometimes it takes really long. Sometimes it seems really impossible. Sometimes we forget to remember. And sometimes we forget to celebrate. Let me ask you this question. How well do you wait? How strong is your faith? Do you sometimes forget? Do you celebrate God's goodness regularly? Before we jump in, let's pray. Lord Jesus, we love this season in the church. A season where we see your first coming, where we anticipate your second coming, and where we once again marvel at how this whole story played out. We sing songs that resonate to the depth of our hearts, of the joy that was experienced, of the night that you came, and all the promises that were fulfilled. Lord Jesus, speak to us now through your word. Fill us with your power. Fill us with your spirit. Illuminate our hearts and minds. Encourage and edify and strengthen and admonish us. Give us what we need now in this moment, Lord Jesus, through your word that is alive. We pray that in your name. Amen. Again and again in the Old Testament, God promises, listen, a broken and pained world that he will send a Messiah. I am going to do it. A Messiah means a deliverer, means a savior, means a king, means an anointed one. I will send this one, and this one will start to renew and restore all things. Remember, the story of the Bible starts with everything perfect and in its place. It ends with everything perfect and in its place. But in between, you see the brokenness of everything that was once perfect. And then you see the start of the restoration of everything that was once perfect. And then you see the completion or the redemption of all of it through Jesus after the time of the church and of the Holy Spirit. So God says, I will send someone. Let's read two Old Testament prophecies, Isaiah 9, verse 1 to 7. Now, I don't have time to tell you of all the names and all the historical details in the text, unfortunately, but let's just read it for what it is. This is Isaiah speaking. He's making God's will known to God's people. God's people is being warned that everything they know will be taken from them. They will be punished for their sin because they have turned their backs on God. So Isaiah says, turn back to God, repent, and the people keep on going on their ways. And in this part of the book of Isaiah, he says, even though you might lose everything, even though your world as it was known to you will be broken, nevertheless, the gloom of the distressed land will not be like that of the former times when he humbled the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. So he's calling historical moments that we find in the Old Testament. But in the future, he will bring honor to the way of the sea, to the land east of the Jordan, and to Galilee of the nations. So God will do something in the future. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. A light has dawned on those living in the land of darkness. You have enlarged the nation and increased its joy. Ooh, that sounds awesome. The people have rejoiced before you as they rejoice at harvest time and as they rejoice when dividing spoils, right? Joy will return to the people. For you have shattered their oppressive yoke and the rod on their shoulders, the staff of the oppressor, just as you did on the day of Midian. For every trampling boot of battle and the bloodied garments of war will be burned as fuel for the fire. Something happened and something will pass. God will deal with it. He'll put it away into history. For a child will be born for us. Verse 6. A son will be given to us and the government will be on his shoulders. He will be named Wonderful Counselor. Yes, amen. Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace. That's the ruler we want. The dominion will be vast and its prosperity will never end. He will reign on the throne of David and over his kingdom to establish and sustain it with justice. Yes, that's the kind of king we want. And righteousness. Yes, that's the kind of king we want. From now on and forever, the zeal of the Lord of armies will accomplish this. Yes, yes, yes. That's a promise. in the Old Testament that God had to keep. Let me read you another one, Micah 5, verse 1 to 4. Now, daughter who is under attack, once again speaking to God's people, you slash yourself in grief, a siege is set against us. They are striking the judge of Israel on the cheek with a rod. Bethlehem Ephratah, you are small among the clans of Judah. One will come from you to be ruler over Israel for me. His origin is from antiquity, from ancient times. Sunday school question. Who's Micah talking about? He's talking about Jesus. Verse 3, therefore Israel will be abandoned until the time when she who is in labor has given birth. Then the rest of the ruler's brothers will return to the people of Israel. He will stand and shepherd them in the strength of the Lord, in the majestic name of the Lord his God. They will live securely, for then his greatness will extend to the ends of the earth. What a encouraging, hopeful word to people who really need it. Now, most scholars agree that by the time we enter the period of the New Testament, you guys saw the timestamp on the video, 4 BC, nearly 400 years had passed since the last messianic promise had been given by God. And the Messiah still hadn't come. 400 years is a long time. The first promise of the Messiah, actually, in the Bible, we find all the way back in the first book of the Bible called Genesis, in chapter 3, verse 15. That's the first promise we find, that one will come to crush the serpent. The serpent will bite his heel, but he will crush the head of the serpent. Yes, someone will overcome evil. Can that someone please just come? So if you take it all the way from Genesis chapter 3 up until the time when the New Testament starts, it's actually not hundreds of years of waiting, it is thousands of years of waiting. And he still hadn't come. Let's be real. Did Israel have a reason to feel hopeless? I think they did, because they've been waiting for a very long time. I asked you earlier, how well do you wait? Fam, let me put my junk out here. I wish that 2 minute noodles could be 1 minute noodles. Because it takes too long. Have you ever sent a WhatsApp message and you hit the green arrow and it doesn't give you the tick immediately? It makes that little clock. It's like a millisecond and you go, oh, no data, I'm gonna die. The internet is down, I need to fix it immediately. We can't even wait for an instant message to be instantly sent because it's too slow. I don't know why you guys are laughing at me. I can't be the only impatient sinner in the house. Just saying. Can you imagine how deep Israel's hopelessness could have been because they've been waiting for 400 years? Imagine how many generations pass in 400 years. Second, third, fourth, fifth generation heard. Hey, listen, your great, 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 great grandpa told your great, great, great grandpa that we should just wait, man. And then great, great told great, and then great told grandpa, and grandpa told me, and now I'm telling you, just wait. He will come. Okay, but Dad, I just want to ask, he hasn't come now in 400 years. So is he still coming? Yeah, he is coming. We should keep on believing. That must have been hard conversations for the people of Israel. And also, if you think about how much they suffered through the course of their history, that just made their hopelessness even deeper, because they've been waiting for the Savior, but while they've been waiting for the Savior, they've really suffered some really hardcore stuff. I mean, if you just think of the history of Israel, I know that not everyone knows the history of Israel necessarily by dates, but just go with me for a bit. In the year more or less 1000, things were going well in Israel, right? David was king. He had a unified kingdom. They were a massive military power, and the country went through a lot of prosperity. The moment he died and his kids succeeded the throne, the history really, really, really went down a downward spiral. To such an extent that in 722, the whole northern part of Israel was taken by the Assyrians. And then in 586, the whole southern part of Israel was taken by the Babylonians. And actually then, the Assyrians took people away into exile, and the Babylonians took people away into exile. So who's left? No one. So no promised land, no throne, no palace, no temple, no nothing. Everything we had, everything God promised to us, we messed it up. And it was taken away from us. And then they live in a foreign land. They walked 2,500 kilometers with their Jerusalem cruisers on to go and live in a country where they don't know the language, the religion, the clothing, the culture, the food, or anything. They had the opportunity to come back. Yeah, that's great. In 538 under Cyrus. But once they came back, they went, you. We're going to have to build. We're going to have to build again. The place looks really sucky. It's not overflowing with anything at the moment. We need to start building again. And that was a hard, hard journey. Until the Greeks came in 333 all the way to 323 under Alexander the Great and went, how's it fam? We are now going to establish our rule here. Everyone will speak Greek. Show us your books. Yeah, well, okay. This God doesn't look as powerful as I am, Alexander the Great. But please translate your Old Testament into Greek so that we can also read it. Okay, thank you very much. From now on, the dominant culture will be Greek. So let's go. Yay. Yay for Greece. And then, just after that, the Roman Empire came. And especially in 167, which was like the high point of their brutality and how they took over the kingdom that was previously known as Israel. And they ruled all the way through until 4 BC when Mary and Joseph made their way down to Bethlehem. You guys should know, and you do know, that the Roman occupation of Israel in that time was very, very brutal. It was hard to live under them. All of this prefaced by 400 years of silence. I don't know about you, but I would have asked the question, why hasn't he come? And I think they could have had thoughts like this. One, the Roman powers are just too strong. It's possible. I mean, have you seen Rome? And have you seen how they rule with an iron fist? Because the people knew of a realm called the spiritual realm, I think the people could have thought, well, it might not be Rome that's too strong, but I think all the forces and principalities and dominions, all the spiritual powers against God and against His Messiah might just be winning the fight at this point. Check this one. What if they thought that they sinned too much? What if they thought that they were undeserving of the promise being kept? I might have thought that. I mean, if you just read the Old Testament, it's not too difficult to imagine how people went, maybe we took it a step too far, you know? As an earthly father who is a sinner, I sometimes say these words to our kids. I have had enough. It's the worst words to say to kids because like, what do you mean with it? But I do it. I don't recommend it. Absolutely, you need to repent after that and then share the gospel with them and tell them why you were wrong to say it, just saying. But I mean, if you read the Old Testament, it's not too difficult to go, I think God might have had enough of His people. Maybe they thought that, like, this really needs a miracle, a colossal miracle. Like, if we would imagine what it would mean for the Messiah to come and establish His reign, and you tick all the boxes and you plan the whole project, It's a miracle. And maybe it's too big of a miracle or too much of a miracle. So because the coming of the Messiah was a long time coming, see what I did there? It was easy for people to start to think of it as an impossibility. Why? South African English. Because sometimes it takes really long. Nothing is impossible with God. Why does it sometimes then feel impossible? Well, here's the second point, and that is that sometimes it seems really impossible. Okay, so we spoke about two messages that broke this 400 years of silence. Do you guys realize that? Like the message to Mary and the message to Joseph was the 400-year silence that was broken right there. So we read the angel's message to Mary in the teaching text. Let's read the angel's message to Joseph as we find it in the book of Matthew chapter 1. The birth of Jesus Christ came about this way. After his mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, it was discovered before they came together that she was pregnant from the Holy Spirit. So her husband Joseph, being a righteous man and not wanting to disgrace her publicly, decided to divorce her secretly. That's why the video clip was so beautiful to me. She said, "Thank you for not divorcing me." And then if you read the Bible, then you go, oh, yeah, well, he actually did decide to divorce her secretly. But after he had considered these things, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, "Joseph, son of David, don't be afraid to take Mary as your wife, because what has been conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to name him Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." Now all this took place, verse 22, to fulfill what was spoken by the Lord through the prophet. "See, the virgin will become pregnant and give birth to a son, and they will name him Emmanuel," which is translated, "God is with us." When Joseph woke up, he did as the Lord's angel had commanded him. We need to acknowledge that the details of how God was going to bring Jesus into the world would have made it seem even more impossible. I mean, think about this. We live in the world of strategic planning and project planning. We talk about SWOT analysis. We think of ourselves as really clever and able to sort out some plans and look for solutions. How would you have done it? Because if you study this story, you'll see that God is going to use a teenage girl. He's going to use a guy a little bit older than her to be this king's stand-in mother and father. How's that? Secondly, they weren't rich. They were probably part of a community that only earned 200 days worth of wages in a 365-day year. So they had food every second day. They had no real religious standing. They had no real social standing. And they lived in a place called Nazareth. In the sticks. Like if I would say to us from Pretoria, it's like Ravelow, just between Vryburg and Swaiserenike. You'll go, what? No, just past Stella. So Stella, Ravelow, Swaiserenike. You know where that is? It sounds far. That's how Nazareth was. She'll conceive the Messiah while she's still a virgin. How's that for a plan? That's never happened. And she'll remain a virgin until he's born. That's also never happened. So we're taking quite a big risk here. And then, using all of these details, do you think that people will believe this and that they will actually follow this Messiah? Is this how God's going to do it? Is this really how God is going to do it? It sounds wild to us. But that was his plan and in his wisdom. Now just think about what must have gone through their heads as they weighed whether or not this could even be possible. I mean, think about this. Mary's concern was, is Joseph going to leave me? Because if Joseph leaves me with a baby, I'm dead and the baby's dead, period. Because we don't have any money, I can't work, and I also can't work while I rear a baby. And secondly, because I conceived of this baby while out of wedlock, I'll be ostracized by my family, so I've got nowhere to go. That's the kind of stuff that went through Mary's head. Did you guys ever think about how will we care for this baby? Because we're not earning a lot of money, you know, and babies are expensive. They need stuff. Have you guys ever thought about them thinking about how they will train this kid? I mean, think about it. If I get this revelation that we will receive a son and he will become the next Ibn Ezebet, and I have to make sure that he plays lock for the Springboks. Fam, I'm not a lock. So I wouldn't know how to go about it. Like, at least I'll know that the kid needs to eat a lot of food. But I don't know how to train the kid to be the best lock in the world. They have got no idea how to train royalty, because they're not. All of these concerns, like a whirlwind in their heads. And despite all of these concerns, nipping at their heels, Joseph and Mary pressed on. That's why I wanted to show you the video. Did you see them all sweaty and dirty without water on the donkey? But he keeps on looking at the thing he's supposed to do. Relentlessly, they pressed on. Why? Because they believed that God was going to do what he said he'll do. And even when it seemed really impossible to them, they were faithful. It begs the question that demands an answer from us, and that is, how on earth were they able to do so? How were they able to relentlessly press on, to keep on believing when everything seemed so impossible? So we've said that sometimes it takes really long. We've said sometimes it seems really impossible. Let's look at the third one. Sometimes we forget to remember. I just asked the question, how were they able to relentlessly press on, keep on believing when everything seemed so impossible? Here's the answer. Because they relentlessly remembered. So what did they remember? Think about the video clip that I showed. There was a moment when Mary is speaking, and then Joseph says, God told me to. Did you see it? So, remembering God's word to you. Remembering what He says to you. And remembering what He promises you helps us to keep on pressing on when things seem really impossible. So, God told him, God has authority, therefore he's obedient to this God who has the authority. But not only did God tell him, he also remembered that this God has a proven track record of his authority. Does that make sense to you? Mary says, yes, yes, but remember what the messenger said to me. So they remembered that they were called by God Himself. They remembered that God has a proven track record of accomplishing what He promises. And therefore, they kept on pressing on. So their remembering of God's faithfulness and Him keeping their promises wasn't only limited to what God said to them in that moment through their messengers. They know that this God that gave them this message is also the God who's always been faithful to everything He said. I don't want you guys to miss this. It's awesome if you have a word. It's awesome if you have a promise. It's awesome if you can point back to your journal and say, on that day, God promised me this, and I am waiting for this. That's awesome. But if you don't have that, that's not what is needed for you to be able to remember God's goodness and His faithfulness, because He's been good and faithful since the start of this whole story. That's really, really important for us to know. So some don't have more to believe in than others. The God who promises, the God who we speak of, the God who is faithful, has always been faithful. Nothing has ever been impossible for Him. And that is a declaration from the angel to Mary. And as the angel declares this to Mary, she has an invitation. And what is her invitation? Her invitation is to consider whether the declaration is true or not. Think about this. The angel declares, nothing is impossible to God. You either say, amen, I believe, or you say, I don't know. But you have to make a decision. You can't just sit on the fence. So it's an invitation to remember, and not only to think of God's faithfulness in your own life, really small, but to think about how God has always been able to accomplish the impossible. Mary and Joseph were people of the book.
They were Jewish people. They sat in synagogue. They heard the scriptures read. They know the stories of Israel. They know that God started one colossal family through one person and his really old wife who couldn't conceive a child. That was impossible, but for God it was possible. God was the one who broke the back of Egypt and who engaged in this 10-round heavyweight boxing fight with Pharaoh, and he won. It seemed impossible, but it wasn't in the end. God was the one who took his people to the promised land, a land overflowing with milk and honey, occupied by other people actually in that time, after a 40-year period in the wilderness when everyone said, will this ever happen? And God made it happen. God was the one who gave a shepherd boy the power to slay a giant. Impossible, but possible with God. Maybe Mary recalled the story of Abraham and Sarah. Well, she did actually, because just after our teaching text, from verse 46 to 55, we find a song of praise from Mary. In Latin, it's called the Magnificat. And in the Magnificat, she actually mentions the story of Abraham and Sarah. Why? Because it involves a couple who welcomed a kid into the world despite impossible odds. So if God could do it for them, He can do it in me. And I trust Him for it. Do you guys see how important remembering is? But do you guys see how important remembering is, not only for you in the amount of years that you've lived on this world, but also to just lift your eyes and look at how He's been faithful to everyone you know, and then lift your eyes even further and read His word and read the story and see that that is who He is. We sing songs in this church like, even when I don't see it, You're working. Even when I don't feel it, You're working. We sing songs in this church of the goodness of God, saying, you're never going to let us down. We believe it when we sing it, but we also need to believe it on Monday when we get retrenched. And we also need to believe it on Tuesday when we see someone die. And we also need to believe it on Wednesday when our bank account is zero. And we also need to believe it on Thursday and Friday and Saturday. And that's where that belief comes from. Study the story. Know the story. And then you encounter God and you see that this God that you're encountering is consistent with the God of the story. If you listen closely, you would have heard that was part of Matlatsi's testimony this morning. God did something impossible. And then I went, well, then that has to mean that He's alive. Because it was impossible. Did you hear it? We can play it again if you want to. No, I'm joking. Let me show you our discipleship journey again. We are a disciple-making church. If you want to know what that means, ask Kone. I'm joking. You did well this morning explaining it. At Fellowship City, we say that a disciple loves God and loves people. And we say a disciple loves God and loves people through knowing God, through committing faithfully, and through giving generously. Look at the top. A disciple knows God. How? Through His Word. And through encountering Him. And through worship. The sister Mary, the teenage girl, pregnant out of wedlock, she knew His Word. And then she encountered Him through a message. And then she wrote a song of praise in Luke called the Magnificat. She knows the one she speaks of. Do you know the one you speak of? We need to remember. I know that you're hearing Mufasa in your head. Remember who you are. Not going to bring that into the message at this point. Just saying. Do you remember your own salvation story? Think about it. God pursued you. He was chasing after you. He was kicking walls of resistance down to get to you. He revealed Himself to you again and again, and at some point, He pierced your heart. Boom! Just went for it. The proposal. Will you marry me? And then he welcomed you when you just couldn't resist him anymore. You might remember that, but let's for a second remember what he's done for you since that day. This year, coming year in May, I'll be celebrating 20 years of following Jesus. Fam, if I need to start telling you what God has done for me and through me in these 20 years, I'll keep you here until the new year. Do you remember that? Do you remember everything that He's done for you? Or sometimes I ask myself this question, where would I have been if God had not chased me down? If God had not called me back to Him? If God had not stopped me from committing suicide and rather lavished me with His love and grace, where would I have been? Where would you have been? Remember, fam. Remember. You might sit in this place today and you actually might not be in a relationship with Jesus, but you're really feeling this thing that I'm talking about. God calling, God revealing, God pursuing, and God touching your heart. I want you to know that if that is what you are feeling, go for it. Run to Him. We make it really simple at our church. We say that God gives us the gift of faith, and then we grip the gift by taking a leap of faith. Or let me explain it this way. We say the gospel is that Jesus suffered as a substitute for our salvation so that you can be in a relationship with the Father again. And then we explain salvation like this. You repent, you turn, and then you receive forgiveness, and then you remember this good news. It's as easy as ABC. You admit your sins, you believe in the forgiveness that's to be found in Jesus, and you confess Him as your Lord and Savior. I'm telling you now that if you are not a Christian yet, God is coming for you. And that's the best news that I can share with you. He is going to keep on coming and keep on coming and keep on coming until all resistance breaks down. Because no one is resistant to love. No one. And He's going to keep on loving you. The coming of the Messiah was never to be thought of as an impossibility, because if they remembered, they would have seen that all things had already been proven possible for God. Do you see how important remembering is? Let's take the last one. Why does this sometimes feel impossible? Because sometimes we forget to celebrate. So we've spoken about it takes long, we've spoken about it seems impossible, we've spoken about the fact that we forget to remember. The last thing is, sometimes we forget to celebrate. Today marks the beginning of what we call Advent. Advent means coming. Who's coming? Jesus is coming to earth to be born, and also because we are on the other side of His birth, death, resurrection, ascension of Jesus Christ, we are awaiting His return. It's called the second coming. You would have seen on our artwork the word Advent. Ava stood in front of me while worship. No, actually, that was Katie, our younger one. She stood in front of me and she went, "Hey, Dad." And I went, "Yes, buddy." And she goes, "Why does it say Advent on the slide?" And I'm like, "Yes, for great designs." Boom! And also, "Yes, for an inquisitive child." Like, she wants to know what we're busy with. And I was like, "Ah, dude, that's actually a Latin word. And it just means coming. And who are we waiting to come? We're waiting for Jesus to come." She goes, "Yeah. Okay, cool. I can see that." And then she kept on worshiping, which was great. This season leads us up to Christmas Day, which was the beginning of the renewal and the restoration of a broken and pained world. And then this season leads us to look ahead to when Jesus will come again and He will finish His renewing and restorative work. And it should give us great hope, and we should celebrate that. That is why we do it every year. Fam, Jesus said He's coming back. In the Gospel of Matthew, you find it in chapter 24 and 25, "I am coming back." In the Upper Room Discourse in the Gospel of John, chapters 13 to 17, Jesus says, "I have to leave you for a bit, I'm going to prepare a place for you. I'm going to send you the paraclete, the special helper, and then I am coming back. Don't be afraid. Don't lose heart. Don't fear. Paul the Apostle, 1 Thessalonians, 2 Thessalonians, two letters he wrote to the church in Thessalonica. He says, Jesus is coming back. This is more or less how it will happen, and this is more or less when it will happen, and this is what needs to be accomplished. It's a reality. The book of Revelation, the whole second half of Revelation, Jesus takes center stage, and what is it about? It's about Him completing His work. Finishing what He started. A life centered and saturated around the truth of the perfect birth. Life, death, resurrection, ascension, and return of Jesus Christ. This church believes it. That's what we preach. That's what we sing. That is the way we look at the world. We've been waiting for a very long time for Jesus to come again and finish His work. Israel waited for hundreds of years. We have been waiting for thousands of years for His second coming. And that's why this messenger's word to Mary is also a word to us. Nothing is impossible with God. It's a declaration to Mary, and it's an invitation to Mary. It's a declaration to us, and it is an invitation to us. And we need to remember this and celebrate this as we wait and wrestle against hopelessness. Fam, real talk, if I'm at my most hopeless, my prayer sounds like this. Lord Jesus, will you please come back today? Now. Because I'm done. I don't have hope anymore. I don't want to teach anymore. I don't believe that the church will advance anymore. I don't think that people are serious about you. I'm tired of all the false prophets in this world. I'm tired of nominal Christianity. I'm tired of consumerism. I hate social media. Please come back now. At my most hopeless. And then I remember that even though it seems really impossible to me, it's not impossible for Him. And He will do it. In His time, and then I celebrate the fact that He did it more than once, and then I celebrate the fact that I can find hope in Him doing it again. Do you guys see it? When we're hopeless, we think back of the stories of old. We see how God has always been able to accomplish the impossible. The only way that we can keep going, fam, is if we remember what God has faithfully brought about in the past and in the present. Think about it. The birth of Jesus seemed impossible. The ministry of Jesus seemed impossible. The resurrection of Jesus seemed impossible. The furthering of God's kingdom and His mission through the church seemed impossible. But all of those things happened, and we are part of that story now. How has God been faithful to you? Just take a moment and just think about it. And if you are a note taker, write it down. If you're a mental note taker, then make a mental note. It'll help us to remember. So the second coming of Jesus is never to be thought of as an impossibility, because all things have already been proven possible for God. So in this time leading up to Advent, we're remembering the coming of Jesus. We remember that it changed everything and that it brought about a great turn in the world. We remember that the world went from hopeless and shameful and sad and self-concern and self-preservation through this child that was born to a world of hope and a world of peace and a world of joy and a world of love. Nothing is impossible with God. This gives us great hope, a confident expectation that nothing is impossible for God because nothing has ever been. Amen. As our worship ministry makes their way to the stage, I just want to offer a few responses. When it comes to something taking really long, maybe your response today is, Lord Jesus, please teach me how to wait. Will you please give me patience? And fam, if you pray that and your patience is tested tomorrow, don't be surprised. I mean, how on earth can we ask God to grow us in something and then expect no resistance? Make me patient. Teach me how to wait. If you think of the second point, something that seems really impossible, maybe your prayer or your response is, Lord Jesus, I don't believe. I don't. Like I want to. But I really struggle. And my faith just isn't strong. Every time I have to trust you, I fail. Every time I have to believe, I just can't do it. I do so well on a Sunday service, but I struggle so hard on a Tuesday afternoon. Maybe that's your response, is just strengthen my faith. Sometimes we forget to remember. So maybe a good response for you today would be, please give me space in which I can think and in which I can reflect. I know you've been good to me. I know you've done the impossible, but I never have an opportunity to even think about it. All of my days and all of my minutes and all of my seconds are so filled. Please help me with space in which I can think and reflect and rejoice. Maybe today you just need the Holy Spirit to give you joy again. You know that it's one of its fruit, you know. And gratitude. When was the last time you thanked God for everything? And you listed it. And you kept on thanking Him until you've got nothing left. No jokes, last year on the Comrades Marathon, my brother and I reached the top of Fields Hill. It's a 3 kilometer downhill just after you ran 60 kilometers. And my legs were shot and it was hot and I could see that my brother was going through a tough spot. So I just decided for the next 3 kilometers I'm going to thank God. That's what I'm going to do because that's the only way I'm going to get down this hill. Fam, those were the best 3 kilometers of my whole race because once I started getting going, 3 kilometers wasn't enough for me to be grateful. So we passed down Fields Hill, all the way through Pinetown, to Cowies Hill, up Cowies and down Cowies, and I was still busy with my thank fest. And just like that, the kilos passed. You've got a lot to say thank you for. And maybe today that's your repentance and that's your prayer. If that's you, let me pray. Father God, nothing is impossible for you. We know that and we believe that. And today we choose to remember that. In light of the story of Christmas, in light of the story of the Old Testament, in light of the story of our lives, in light of even our last week, you were the one who showed that you are faithful and that you will keep your promises. So Lord Jesus, give us the patience we need to wait. Give us the faith we need to trust something that according to our grids doesn't seem possible. Liberate us from the rat race and the so-called hamster wheel that we can sometimes be caught on. Show us your glory and show us your face again in a new way. Give us space where we can just be in awe of who you are. Give us joy, make us thankful as we think about your first and your second coming, Lord Jesus. We pray that in your name. Amen.